Welcome to the Diversity Scholarship Foundation's Profiles in the Law. And my name is Jesse Reyes. I'm president of the foundation. And this is a series of conversations that we're having with prominent leaders in the legal profession. And today's guest is Kristen Barnett McCarthy. Welcome.
Welcome. Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.
Oh, it's our pleasure. Our pleasure. And you're the current president of the Women's Bar Association of Illinois.
Since June.
Okay, and we're getting a little bit about the Bar Association and the foundation, if you could talk a little bit about that as well. But tell us a little bit about yourself. I mean, you went to a law school here in Chicago?
I did. I went to DePaul. I graduated in 2004. And I worked during that time. In the summers, you have the opportunity to test out different things. And actually, before law school, I worked in the summer at the Public Defender's Office in Skokie.
Mm-hmm. And what was that experience like?
It was very interesting. I saw a wide variety of things going on, whether it's, everywhere there's crime and there's mm-hmm. people that need to be defended. Domestic violence, abuse to animals, DUIs, traffic violations, murders. You see everything just like you see anywhere else.
And so this was before you went to law school?
That was before I went to law school.
Okay. And then when you were in law school, did you work anywhere else during the summer?
Sure. I worked 26 in California with the state's attorney's office for Cook County. Bond court, preliminary hearings. Got to see a little bit of some grand jury things. But when you're in law school and you're relatively young, pretty much we stuck to bond court and preliminary hearings. But we got to see some interesting murder trials. If you go into the different courtrooms, everything is going on at 26 in California.
So you got to see a little bit of both, the defense side and then also the prosecution side before you, in fact, became a lawyer.
That's true.
Great experience.
That's true.
So after you graduated from law school, what kind of work did you do?
Initially, and actually after the state's attorney's office, I worked in a plaintiff's firm doing medical malpractice, assisting as a clerk, of course, and assisting with appeals. I had a little taste for personal injury work, but I decided to go and try cases, and I did it on the defense side of things, defending personal injury cases for insurance companies.
Okay. So again, getting that double-edged experience in terms of being on the plaintiff's side and then being on the defense side.
That's right. And I worked on the defense side for about 8 years. And then one day I got a call from Al Schwartz, and who's a prominent plaintiff's attorney, and he asked me to come and work for him. So then I flipped again and went from the defense side of things to personal injury work again, as I had done in law school.
And that's where you're currently employed?
True, yes.
Right. And you're a partner in the firm?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, and the firm is?
Kralovic, Jamboy, and Schwartz.
Okay. Can you tell our viewers what did you learn from being able to be on both sides? On the criminal side, being prosecution and then defense, and then also then on the civil side, being on the defense side and then also on the plaintiff side, particularly for our young viewers who may be thinking about a career in the law and the opportunities that are out there and what that diverse background might do for them in their future careers.
Well, I think the most important thing that a lawyer, has to have is objectivity. So it's important, to understand that there's two sides to everything. And you should be able to go in. I think that one job interview, somebody said, well, you worked for a plaintiff's law firm. We do defense. How do you feel about, if I hand you a case, what do you think? And I said, well, you just tell me, am I the plaintiff or am I the defendant? On the criminal side of things, everyone deserves a defense, and the state has to prosecute its cases. So it's a matter of understanding both sides of that, not just seeing it from one point of view. With regard to defending personal injury cases and looking at the plaintiff side of thing, looking at somebody who's injured, it's important. I look at cases from all angles, and I think that it's important to have that background and to be able to look and not just see it from one point of view. You're able to evaluate and tell somebody up front, here's what I believe the weaknesses are of your case, here's what I believe the strengths are of your case, and not just give them one side.
And for our younger viewers that might be interested in a career of the law, you would suggest to seek out employment like you did during the summer programs and work in some of these offices?
It's the best way to understand and see what's going on in those places, to see if you enjoy that or to build off of that. It never hurts to go and give it a shot and see if that's what you want to continue to do or and try different things. And then, you know, try something else and see which you prefer most. Or at least have that, get that experience of seeing, so you have a better understanding and the depth of things.
And you're a very busy trial lawyer.
It's true. I have a full docket. Always busy. I always have, you know, unfortunately, people, car accidents happen all the time. People get injured all of the time. So, you know, when the phone rings, whenever I give somebody my card, I always say, here's my card. I hope you never need to call me.
And then one of the things that, or one of the matters, I should say, that you tend to handle is nursing home abuse. Could you tell our viewers a little bit about, you know, what to do if they encounter, if they become aware of it?
Sure. You know, I handle a bunch of different cases, and one of those happens to be cases that involve nursing home abuse or neglect. It's a very sad thing if you think about it. You know, somebody's lived their entire life. They didn't get struck by a car and killed. They didn't die of cancer. They live past, you know, having children. They, you know, didn't go down in a plane, and they get to this stage in their lives where they can no longer care for themselves, and they need help. And maybe their families can't help, and the best place is to get this care at somewhere else. And you put your trust into a facility, and bad things happen. A lot of times there's understaffing, or maybe it's not as clean. There's neglect as far as nutrition, feeding, because, you know, sometimes people, if they don't feel well or aren't able to articulate their needs, they don't make sure that you're eating. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes people can't get out of bed any longer, and they aren't able to use the restroom on their own. I think it's important that people who have family members are aware of what's going on there, and if they believe that there's a problem, anybody can reach out to the Illinois Department of Public Health. If you have a computer, you can reach out there. Everything is, if you Google Illinois Department of Public Health, you can report that. If it's questions about, I think it's important that everyone understands their rights of what's going on. I mean, and if that's part of my job is, you know, I don't encourage everybody to go out and file a lawsuit or have a case, but one thing that I think everybody should know is what are your rights. Mm-hmm. And not get too past, because everything has a timeline on it, and to have that understanding, so at least you don't look back 10 years later or 5 years later and say, maybe I should have done something, when it's too late. So reach out and call somebody, or ask if you have a complaint at a nursing home, tell the people there, go to the management, or call a lawyer.
Is there a time frame in terms of reporting abuse in nursing homes, in terms of proceeding?
I think it's important as quickly as you can do these things. Obviously, you know, if you have a complaint and you want it to be addressed and something bad is going on, the quicker you complain, the better off whatever is going on is mm-hmm. going to be resolved quicker if you do it right away. Mm-hmm. If you don't do something, if you don't say something, you can't necessarily expect that thing to change or them to fix it, right?
Right. So if you have a loved one that's in a nursing home, I guess best thing to do is make sure that you just check on them periodically to make sure.
Yeah, have a relationship. Know who's taking care of, you know, your family member. Go there. You know, being present and having an understanding of what's going on with that person, if they're being rehabilitated, that they're eating, that they're clean, that they're being taken care of, and that they are being paid attention to.
Yeah, well, that's very, very good advice. So aside from being a very busy lawyer and a partner in a large firm, you find time to be involved in the legal community in terms of bar associations and
some of us can't help ourselves, right?
So tell us, how did you become involved in the Women's Bar Association?
Interestingly enough, on my first day of law school, they had all the organizations put out tables, and everyone was, telling about their different groups, and it just made sense to me. It was the Women's Bar Association of Illinois, and I figured, I'm a woman. I naturally need to be a member of this, and they kind of took me under their wing, After my first year of law school, they asked me to be the president of the organization at DePaul. And so I did that, and I kind of had a lot of fun with it and recruited new members. And so my slogan, kind of based on my experience of, if I'm a woman, why wouldn't I be a member of this, was, if you're a woman, why not be a member? Mm-hmm. You know, you're a woman. This is all about you. We do have male members, though, by the way, and we have interesting things. Not everything is just solely for women. It's for professionals, and we do a lot of good things, but... So my second year when I was president, I became involved with a professional board, the Women's Bar Association of Illinois, which now I'm a part of, and I had some mentor-mentee groups, and we did a lot more things with them, and I would volunteer for a lot of events, and just started attending and becoming more involved every year until I was selected to be on the board, and then work your way up. So I've kind of been a part of the Women's Bar as long as I've been involved in law.
That's almost. Great. So what are some of your initiatives for your year?
We have something for every kind of interest. We have a community outreach group that does a lot of number of things, including things with after school matters. We do things involving, there's a number of shelters, I believe, that our people go out to, but we change it every year. Mm-hmm. So this month we don't have anything going on. It's the summer. We kind of try to give everybody a little bit of a break. Mm-hmm. But in the fall there's going to be events, but that's one committee that's of interest to many people, because community outreach is something that's of interest. Sure. Regardless of what area of law. We have a criminal justice committee, we have a family law committee, we have a in-house counsel committee. We have a task force that we joined in with the CBA for women and aging. Mm-hmm. That deals a little bit sometimes with elder law. We have a civil litigation committee. So we have a lot of fun things, and we have very focused things. We have a golf outing coming up. You know, that's more fun. It's not as specific, it's not really on topic with anything. We have continuing legal education programs. We have things involving women. Whether if you're a lawyer and you have anxiety, we do things where we have somebody come out and teach yoga. Just lots of different. They did a cooking class last year. A little bit of everything.
So Women's Bar is also very involved in Women Everywhere.
Correct.
So could you tell us a little bit about the Women Everywhere project?
Women Everywhere is a project that they partner with the Chicago Public Schools, and once a year we try to arrange our transportation for teenage, high school-aged females to come downtown and go to the various courthouses and get a tour, and they get to talk to judges, and the judges a lot of times will have something put on for them in the courtroom, and they get to meet the clerks, they get to meet the sheriffs, ask lawyers questions, then there's a luncheon that follows. The criminal courthouse has its own, and the district courts have their own as well. Skokie puts on a big one, and in addition there's a volunteer day. We have lawyers and law firms and some corporations that want to get involved, and so we reach out to charities, and there's a day that lawyers, judges, and some corporations that are interested go out and try to volunteer, and whatever the organization is, whatever their needs are, whether it's planting flowers, helping to sort things. One group wanted us to give resume advice, that sort of thing. It's all over the all over the board as far as what the volunteer activities are.
And I have to say, you know, having been involved in it, that a lot of these young women that participate, this is their first exposure to lawyers, to judges, to the court system. So I think it's a great program, because it gives them, you know, an awareness of the other things that go on in our courthouse and within the legal community.
Yeah, I think it's great for them to be able to see that we're all people. You know, we all come from different places and have different interests. There's lots of different things that you can do in a courthouse, not just be a judge, not just be a lawyer, but the sheriffs are so important too. The clerks are integral. What would we do without, you know, the clerks? They make everything function. And you get to see that it's not something that's so scary. It's not something that's all bad. Right. It's not something where everyone who goes to Harvard or comes from a certain place.
Right. And also, throughout the years, the Women's Bar Association has been very active in trying to promote and help others. And one of those initiatives became the Women's Bar Foundation. So could you tell us a little bit about the Women's Bar Foundation?
Sure. I'm on the advisory council for the Women's Bar Foundation, and I'm on the board of the Women Everywhere Project, actually. But for the Women's Bar Foundation, it's a foundation that raises money to give scholarships to one female law student in each of the accredited law schools in Illinois. The deans make recommendations, so if you're a law student, the deans usually are the ones that are in charge of this, but you can always express your interests. The deans make a couple recommendations, and they send us a letter on tell us about the individual, and then there's an interview with every candidate, and the board and or advisory council then makes decisions, and they hand out a scholarship to one female from each of the law schools. It's one of the most meaningful days of the year when we have those interviews. It's a long day. It's a Saturday, and it goes 8 to 10 hours. Usually there's a lot of tears. These stories are heartbreaking. These girls are so interesting, they're so intelligent, they're so driven. They create these programs internationally, they speak 5 different languages that they've taught themselves. It's just incredible, the things that they've overcome. Everyone's story is very, very moving. It's a very wonderful day. We love that day to be able to meet these law students. And they're all different ages. It's people that have gone back to law school. It's not just young females. It's wonderful.
No, I've attended the luncheon as a sponsor. We're very happy and proud to participate in promoting the program. But I agree with you. I mean, you listen to some of these resumes, Aaron. Like, these are students. They haven't even gotten into the profession
right.
yet.
And right.
They're doing all these great things. Like, it's amazing. It's great work, and I want to commend the Women's Bar and the Women's Bar Foundation for doing that.
The Women's Bar Foundation is a very special it's a very special organization. It's wonderful. I really enjoy it.
Yeah. Now, through the years, you've had some very prominent members, like Judge Hooten. Could you say a little bit about Judge Hooten and her involvement with the Bar Association?
Judge Hooten, she was a leader in her field, and she loved the Women's Bar Association. The Women's Bar loved her, and she wanted the Women's Bar to have a home. And she wanted, and when unfortunately, when Judge Hooten passed away, she left the Women's Bar a fund that we then named the Hooten Fund. And instructed that the money that she left was to go towards a home for the Women's Bar. So with that money, we purchased the office in the CBA building, and we use that fund specifically only for things involving our office and the how the office functions and all those things, and it's carefully watched over. We have a Hooten committee, and they oversee the funds to make sure what's going on. Do we need to raise the funds? If we need to spend any of the funds, it has to be approved by the Hooten committee. If our office, for example, if every 10 years our office needs to be painted, if the carpet's shot, that kind of a thing. She definitely has a legacy within the Women's Bar Foundation, or within the Women's Bar Association. We wouldn't have a home without her. It was really a very smart idea by her.
All right, and at least, as you said, you have a home, you have a place where, members maybe want to go to, or a central area where, communication can be conducted, so
we have our meetings there, as a young law student, that's where I would go to. When I first went there, I said, this is not really far from law where I was at DePaul. So I said, I'm going to walk over and see what this is. And you go in, and there's pictures of past presidents, and there's a lot of different interesting things in there. And I encourage anybody who is interested, a law student or a lawyer, to go and check out our office. It's not very big, but it's a special place for us.
Okay. And she was also a little bit of a maverick, right, in her time when she decided she wanted to run to become a judge?
Yeah. Unfortunately, I don't know. Maybe you can inform me a little bit more about the background of that. I don't think that I've heard the story of what she did when she wanted to run for judge.
Well, she did not get the support of the party, or the Democratic Party in Cook County, and decided to run anyway, and she was successful. Ran as an independent, and one of the few independent candidates to run for judge that was successful back in the 1970s.
Learn something new every day.
Yeah.
That's an interesting story. I had no idea.
So who were some of your role models? Who were some of the people that inspired you as you were coming up the women's bar and also within the legal profession?
Well, you know, interestingly, throughout the years, everyone's had different themes in the Women's Bar Association, and some of them are, you know, partnering with your mentor, having a male as your mentor, and there were some natural mentors that I had that it just happened naturally over time. It was not necessarily set, like, oh, will you be my mentor? It's just kind of the way that things developed over time. And I think that it, you know, in the workplace when I was, there was, at the public defender's office, there was a gentleman who worked in the murder unit that dealt with multiple defendants. And he would take me, you know, when he would have a trial coming up, and, we would sit down, he would, you know, tell me about things at lunch, and just, you know, it was really interesting to hear the background of that. And then in law school, when I was working, there was a gentleman that I worked with that taught me everything about legal writing. You know, most people aren't born knowing, at least I wasn't, knowing how to write a brief. And so it's a, you know, it's a hit and miss sort of thing. You can try, but you have to have your own style. And he kind of, I said, you know, I don't know what to do, but if you show me, I will do it. And so that's kind of the way our relationship began. And we're still great friends today. We try to have lunch as often as we can. We pick each other's brains. I really appreciate that. And then also in working, you know, when I became a lawyer, learning how to try a case. At the firm I worked in, you kind of got thrown into the deep end. Here's your case, go figure it out, you know, pick a jury, you're going to be fine. But once you start going, then, you know, you really get some people that will give you pep talks, because it's not, this stuff is not always easy. And sometimes you're thinking, how am I going to get around this issue? And so I definitely have some mentors from that firm that I still will call and run things by and say, what do you think about this?
So a lot of people really don't realize this, and within the legal profession, there are associations like yourself that have mentor-mentee programs, but then as you come along in the profession, there are people who serve as mentors to help you, you know,